Hi there, I'm going to try and make this as quick as possible, but this is probably going to be a little bit of a long one compared to some of the other ones. This is daily coding problem number 3, medium. And it says, given the root to a binary tree, implement serialize root, which serializes the tree into a string, and deserialize s, which deserializes the string back into the tree. For example, given the following node class node, this is like a constructor function. It's just basically setting a value and a left pointer and a right pointer that you can pass in Python instead of using, capital node like it would in Java and a lot of other languages. It uses init, which a constructor method is generally considered an init function. So that makes a lot of sense. And then in Python also, instead of like declaring your instance variables above the constructor or however you do it in whatever language outside of the constructor, you just declare them on the fly with self.val. So basically, instead of maybe in like Java and other languages like that, you would do like a static and then a variable name to declare like a class member variable instead of an instance member variable. In Python, you actually qualify the instance instead of qualifying the class. So anything outside of it would more generally push towards the class instead of, if you were just to define a variable outside. And then if you want to call a method name, a class method name instead of an instance method name, method that applies to a whole class and doesn't refer to an instance, you would you prefix it with the class name. I don't want to get too crazy, but anyway, you can go read up about it on a couple Python articles or something if you're not familiar with Python. Definitely a good time to do so. The following test should pass. You create a node with a bunch of embedded nodes. So as this second, self in Python, you just ignore. That's going to automatically get passed on any object instance. That's like you don't even pass it down here in your constructor. Just whenever you either construct something or whenever you actually like do a dot member function thing, dot member method on there, it will automatically pass in self. And then they just sort of show you where a lot of other languages don't. They'll use like this keyword and they won't show you that this is actually kind of like a variable being passed into your function or your method, I should say. Python makes it a little bit more explicit, so that's why you see that self there. And at first it's a little bit weird, but then after some time goes on, you might kind of like it that it does it like that. That's at least been my experience with it. So anyway, for the most part, you can just ignore that, and whenever you see self, just like how these selfs help you identify the fact that you're talking about an instance variable instead of a class variable, appear these selfs within, as the first parameter into a function or the first argument coming through, I should say, maybe, is letting you know that this is an instance method and not a class method right here. So basically, it's going to take three user passed parameters. And that's going to be a value, which is required positional parameter, and then a left and a right, which are optional. And if you don't supply them, they have a default value of none, which is like null in a lot of other languages. So it will complain if you don't pass value, and if you don't pass the others, then it will just set those equal to the none or null value. And then down here we have an assert statement, which is asserting that we're going to call the serialize function on this little created node, and then before we do anything with that, we're going to pass it into the deserialize function. So this should take a, internal binary tree object and then convert that to serialized, which just is like a string of text, like JSON is a JavaScript object notation. That is a serialized form. It's basically serializing something is going byte after byte sequentially. Usually text a lot of times, like ASCII text. So XML is a serialized format. It's something where you can just more linearly pass a bunch of information across a wire versus parallel or all the other proprietary or internal formats or whatever you want to think of those as. And then deserialize will take that string of text or that string of bytes, and it will convert it back into an internal object. I think I can leave it at that. And if you need to do research on it for sure. Okay, so with that, I'm going to copy this class signature over just to make sure that I get it exactly like they have it. And then I will go back and grab their test stuff. And I'll add those down here as well. And for now, I'm going to comment out hashtags and Python start a comment. And I'm going to comment those out for now. And we'll just work with what we have. And we won't worry about it complaining every time until we've licked it to get rid of those ugly error codes. I know probably nobody's too big of a fan of those. Okay, so what we have here is we can just create a little node object with those three values, and this will create a little bit more of a complex one. This is kind of hard to read. On OneNote, what they want us to do is they want us to create this serialized function, right? Which would be outside of this class, outside of the object that's created by this class as well. And my personal thing with object-oriented programming is this is sort of a red flag to me. I don't think that we should do that. So I am going to modify it. If you do want to follow strictly, it's very easy to do. It's not that big of a difference. You would define the function outside of the class, and this is basically what I'm going to do here is I'm going to just take this node word and I'm going to put it right here and do a dot. Just like that. That's all I'm going to do really to change that. And so you can see effectively it's the same thing, and that's where the self comes into play, because when you call node.serialize, when we create that function right here, def, it's going to get a self. And pass is just kind of like that, just an empty set of curly braces in other languages. But Python doesn't use those crufty braces, so passes just to do that. So right now, that is it's basically the same thing, you know, like as if we define this function outside of a class and we just said this was like node or obj or whatever we want, you know what I mean? So that's basically the only difference that you'd have to do to make this work outside of the function. I am making this as part of the class object and the object because this is specifically an instance method, so you won't be able to just call capital N node dot serialize. You'll have to create a node before you can serialize it because of the whole self thing. If I got rid of self, then it would just be you would call capital node. So that's the only difference, is basically whether you call it with a capitalized N or lowercase n, you know. But anyway, I don't want to explain away too much because I've got to keep moving so that nobody falls asleep that is taking the time to watch this. So anyway, if that's still a question to you, of course, I'm going to let it go without saying more from here on, but look it up for yourself. These are things I'm doing for very specific reasons. They're better practices. A lot of these people that have put up a lot of this stuff to do with like code challenge problems, interview problems, stuff like that, software engineering problems. They have really good intentions, I believe, but they, you know, just like me and like a lot of us, they lack the perfection, right? We're not perfect, so, and we've all been taught by others. One of the things I've happened to spend the last 3 years on, basically at this point, the last 3 years I've spent really getting to know object-oriented programming a lot better. And I would say even more specifically over the last 2 years, I've come to even double down on that. Or like, at first I thought, you know, Java was the epitome of an object-oriented programming language, which it's not by a long shot. And I thought Python was like a joke of an object-oriented programming language. It turns out the inverse is true. So Python is very much closer to a principally pure object-oriented programming language than Java is. So that's something to trip out on and investigate for yourself. I'll throw in a few little pieces along the way here. And I encourage you, go ahead and watch this at like 1.5, 2x speed, whatever, if you need to get through it, or, you know, skip ahead, fast forward through parts. But if you can spare the time, I would suggest just letting this play out and go through it with me. I'll sort of build it up. This is more targeted towards you, reinforcing knowledge for me and building it up in a somewhat educational manner for you that shows a little bit of my process. So I'm not going to be doing things exactly like you maybe want to do it in a code interview, you know. I'm giving you a lot of the rationale behind it to where you could turn, and of course you'd spend several weeks to several months ideally before going to a code interview for a big tech or whatever kind of company you want to think of it as. And you would practice these types of problems and, you know, all the alternatives and whatnot. So you take a little bit more of a maybe a direct approach, and I'm going to do a little bit more fuller and whatever. I'll just get on with it. So we need to serialize this object of itself, which may refer to obviously sort of like embedded, so to speak, like nested objects. You know, this one will point to this one, will point to this one. If you're not familiar with a tree, or not too familiar with a tree anyway, let's go ahead and do this. So the tree they give us as an example would look something more like, let me get this all set up here, get a shape. It would look something more like this. You're gonna have a root node. I'm just gonna copy that one to be consistent here. And then we'd have a left node, and we'd have a right node, and then we'd have a left node down here somewhere. Better scooch all these over a little bit. And this one just up a hair. I'll try not to be too perfectionist about stuff. Okay, and then what happens? I guess I'll go ahead and label these. This one's going to be root, and this one would be, these are the values, left, and this one would be left dot left. This one would be right. So you can see over here what it's looking for is left dot left dot value is left left. So that's what I've showed you here, left.left.value. We're gonna go ahead and change this, and I'll do this to be a little more illustrated of value. Value. So it's like that. Those are the values inside of those bubbles there. These are the nodes of the tree. And then effectively each one's pointing to each one here. I'll go back to the dark and grab a line. So that one's, the left branch is pointing to there, and this one's left branch is pointing to there, and the root's right branch is pointing to there. Just like that. So if we come back over here, one thing in this source editor at least, probably a lot of them might imagine, is you can just go right after each node. So we have that root node. I'm going to go over here so we can see it a little better. I'm just going to hit enter, and then you can see under that we have a left node, which is true, and then I'll hit enter, and it's automatically spacing it over. Nice. So under the left node we have a left node, which is true, and then I will go right out there, and then under root we also have a right node, which is true, and then that's it. So you can see under root we have a node left, which is true, and a node right, which is true, and under node left we have a node left, just like that. And then we can also hit enter on these to see where they align to close out. So we can see this node closes out there, and this node closes out there, has up to two values passed. So there's an implicit none going on in here, like change the color again. I decided maybe it's worth it to go ahead and take the time to kind of explain these basics just in case anybody doesn't know them. So, tools. There's a none right here. Then I can just copy that around. So there's also a none for the left and right on this one. And then there's a none for the left and right on this one. And we don't see that in the constructor, and we also won't see that in our own serialization, which would also, you know, more specifically be a null in other languages, right? Or a false, or some type of falsy value, so to speak. So then I'll come back over here, I'll pick that light gray one, and I'll just kind of go like this to show that there's sort of like a stub there, like a none stub, instead of it actually branching to anything meaningful. So that's how that's looking. And then just kind of building it up, adding some more details so you can see those are more implicitly there, but in our code you can see it is literally for that first, or for the first one, it will pass through value, and you know, it will set the node left to this object, and it will create a node right object. So it effectively is pointing at two objects there. So that's pointing like so. And this one, or I should say like so. And this one's pointing, this left object has one pointer to there. And I'm not drawing the arrow for the nuns because, I mean, arguably under the hood, it is pointing at a nun object. That technically hidden from view, that is true. But we're not pointing at like a user-created object, or so to speak, in high-level terms. So it's really just, it's kind of like in a language, Python technically doesn't really have primitives. Everything's an object, literally. So in a language that does offer primitives like Java, JavaScript, languages like that, you would just have a primitive none there, or a primitive null. So that's why I'm kind of like rolling with that. And we can roll with that idea and it works, and it actually makes more sense in the way we're using things. But just to kind of show you, if I do an n equals none, and then I check if there's an ID on n, there is. And even if I ID none itself, which this is the same ID, right? Because they're both pointing to this single entity of none, which is one of those things, like if you're thinking in more computer sciencey terms, this starts to make a lot more sense. It's not creating like a new instance of none, it's just sharing the same one. So you could just think of none as like this little void, this little black hole, and if you set anything equal to it, there's an arrow pointing off to like all these represent, if I were to draw like a bunch of arrows pointing to like a toilet bowl or something, you know, just like a nothing hole. And that's why they have the same ID. I don't want to get too crazy and it's for another topic, but that's just something to kind of give you an idea of what I was talking about there. So that's that. And then if we think about what's going on here, these left nodes, this is going to be like a, I'm almost done with this little chart. Do tools, image, and then say left. And this one's also a left. And then this one would be a right. Just like that. And even down here, these are lefts and rights. So this one would be a right. Forget I have to double click it. Okay, left. And this one right here would be a right. And this one would be a right. And then maybe I scooch this whole thing over here. And where are we at? This is the left. So there you can see there's the left. There's each one of these has a value, a left, and a right on their self, right? So there's value. Let me switch to maybe a more, I don't know why my hand isn't going over there. So where's a tool that's more pointy? I guess this one. We have the value. We have the value, the left, and the right. Value, left, right. For each one, right? And then these other ones, they just get put to a none and whatever. So let's move on with our lives. And then we can go up here and do like a really simplified version of this and say we have a root, left, a right, and a left dot left. Okay, so let's put these over a little bit. Do a little bit more of a textual representation of these. Something more like that. And I'll comment these out so they don't cause program errors. There we go. So if you see here, this root actually represents the value, and the left, the value. So these are all the values. You know that there's an object that goes there if it's pointing. And then this little line dash slash represents the node left, left and right. So we have value, value, left, excuse me, left. Come on, just select that one. It won't do it. Huh. Left and right. Value, left, value. And then implicit none for the right off of this one. And implicit nones for the left and right off of this one, and implicit nones for the left and right off of that one. Okay, I just want to be very thorough about that. You know, it might seem kind of redundant or stupid, but that's actually helping us wrap our head around that, ideally. Okay, maximize that one. So to serialize ourselves, we are going to... We have that self, which is that implicit node coming in. And serialize, we just want to make a text string. There's several different ways to do this. I'm going to demonstrate just the manual way. It's not only one of the simplest ways, considering the concise stuff or syntax, whatever you want to think of it as. Like, we don't have a whole lot going on here. We don't have to worry about like crazy lists and different number variable, whatever. We can just do like JavaScript object notation is what I'm getting at. We can do like a subset, a very simple subset of JavaScript object notation, which happens to work with Python dictionaries as well, like exactly without any real changes to either one. So you could take this knowledge and even trim even some more off of a lot of it and apply it to JavaScript as well, which would be cool. But of course, I'm doing it with Python. So what we'll do is we will start building up a string. And when we start building up that string, the first thing we're going to need, if we know JavaScript object notation, is going to be the curly brace like this. And then it's going to have a val, because that's our variable that we absolutely have to have. We have to enclose, I'm using the single quotes on the outside, which are preferable for scripting languages anyway, the lightweight quotes. And then on the inside, I'm using the heavyweight double quotes, which are required for JSON. So it just happens to work out nicely like that. So we're going to have that val, and then we're going to also wrap our actual value in quotes. We don't know if it's going to be a string or a number or what. In this case, we do know it's going to be a string, right? So that we're definitely cool wrapping it in quotes. And then I'm going to close off our little string right there and append to it the actual value of ourself. So self.val, and then append to that a closing quote within single quotes. A closing double quote within single quotes, I should say. Okay, so that's got us started right there. And then we're going to do a bunch of stuff in between with the various nodes and all that. And finally, we're going to want to append onto that string a closing brace, you know. So in the very smallest case scenario, we'd have one node. Like if we didn't have these left and right and left left, if we just had the root and two nones, then we would just pass back value self.value, which would be the quote unquote root, and then we would close that off with this brace, and that would be our whole thing. So at this point, we could basically, we're there, so let's go ahead and see if we run it and get no errors. And we can say node, okay, node's an object, node.left is another object, and node.left.left is another object. And if we look at the value, well, and we haven't serialized anything yet. This is just kind of showing us, okay, it looks like we're on the right track. We can see that value, left.left, and we go like that, and that's left. Everything's looking good. And of course, if we go to node.right, we have that value, and node.right is an object. But if we look at node.right.left, there's none. We have to actually print in the REPL. Excuse me here. I have to wrap this in a print statement for you to see that none value, because it's not like a lot of JavaScript interpreters will actually print like undefined or something right there, and you're like, oh, why do I always get an undefined after most of the stuff I run? It's because of that. So Python's kind of cool in the sense that it's like, oh, you probably most of the time don't want to know about none, or you know that it's none. So if you actually want to see it, you got to explicitly print it like that. And then if we actually try and print the value, we get an error because that value would be the object value, which we don't have. We just have left, which is not pointing to anything. So instead of the pointer, instead of this being a pointer like this, see how node.right is an actual object? Node.left is just the, you could just think of it like the keyword none instead of being an actual object, or a keyword null instead of being an object, if that helps. Don't think into it too much, just note that for yourself. Okay, did I not? Now I need to node, not none, dot serialize. Spell it right, serialize. And why, okay, I didn't return that string. So what we'll do here is we'll just say return string, and then we just do string plus that. F5. And then I'll back up to that line. And there we go. So that's just like I was saying, as if we just have the root value, because we're not doing any recursion or anything like that yet to process any more left or right nodes. That all goes right there. And this is a good point to check and make sure, you know, of course, if you're doing like a lot of whiteboard interviews, won't let you use a code editor or compiler or interpreter or anything. So this is just for you to get used to it. I would suggest doing a lot of practice with an interpreter and an editor, syntax editor and all that. And then after you get totally comfortable with that, then you'd want to, of course, try and do it entirely without the interpreter or compiler or editor, and then try and dump that code back into like an integrated environment and run it and see what errors you get. And just keep doing that until you feel like you're on your toes and you can just 99% of the time not get errors and stuff. Okay, so that all looks good. We have our, you know, our single outer quotes, which we're going to have because it's a string, and then our inner string here within the string, we have just the typical JavaScript object notation. And I'm putting in like spaces and, you know, just the typical expected spaces, just like a system would do. That's all up to you. So that's why I've got a space there and whatnot, and none at the end. Okay, so now we just need to fill in and do that recursion. And recursion with trees, binary trees, it's just recursion's going to make more sense. It's, I think, always going to make more sense. So a lot of times with a lot of other solutions, iterative can make a lot more sense and be less crufty to code out. But this is one of those situations where recursion just, it's almost always going to be the answer, unless you're just are going back and optimizing and like, oh, there's too much, it's blowing out the stack because you're just working with massive amounts of data, massive. It's crazy with a tree type of structure like this, what you can get away with using recursion, because you know you're only going to recurse like tens of times versus just thousands or millions of nodes before it unrolls and whatnot like that. So anyway, if resources are delicate or they, you know, to go back and optimize them, that's one thing. But I would say definitely in coding interviews and in real world situations, do follow the KISS principle and follow the DRIVE principle are two most important things always. So that's keep it stupid simple and don't repeat yourself in that order. And that also not only allows you to hash and flesh these things out way quicker and just a way that you can wrap your mind around a lot easier, and the interviewer or code reviewer or somebody else could see very make sense of without having to get into a bad mood. And also it leaves the question open of like, okay, what would you do to improve this, or how would you optimize this or change it like this or that? So instead of like jumping the gun and being like, oh, I'm just gonna type out the whole optimal solution, you know, that can cause everybody stress, I feel like, because then they're like, they're struggling, they're burning a lot of their own mental capacity just trying to keep at pace with what you're doing. And then you know, the only thing they can really say is, okay, well, here, let me pull this way harder problem out of my sleeve now. Where if you kind of build it up incrementally, they know that, like, a lot of times a lot of people at the big tech companies might not even be like full-time coders, so to speak. Like, they might not be writing production code, but they are very familiar with the languages usually, and they know what it's like to work with people, and they know that the teams that they would introduce you to of people and stuff like that know that you want to work with code. Like, sometimes it might seem like baby code or whatever, but it's like, that's good. If you can write just a few lines of code to get the problem done, that's, you know, there's no reason to be clever unless you're going back and optimizing. And then even then you should like be sliding that cleverness out of the way, compartmentalizing it as much as possible. But anyway, so what we're going to do is serialize self. Just trying to reorganize with where I'm at. So we need to check if self.left, because this is going to be a depth first recursion, and that means we're going to go down typically the left side of a tree. I guess if you're in a right to left speaking country, you might go down the right side of trees first, but it's pretty common to always go down the left side of the tree first, and you're going all the way to the bottom down, sticking to the left side, like go to left and left like that. And then once you're done, unroll and then go down the right side. Or if there were right nodes here, as you'd unroll, you'd go to those right nodes and do them, and then go to the next leftmost node and then stick to the left. And then as you unroll, fill in the right nodes and like that. And that's depth first. The other way is breadth first. And that's where you do this one, and then you come down and do this one, and then you do this one, and then you come down and do this one, and any other ones like that. And you basically just do the whole row, so to speak, before you go down a branch. That requires more variables to track. It's a little bit more complex of solution, at least. So when in doubt, when keeping it simple, go with that depth first solution. And depth first, unless you know that what if you're searching a tree and you know your answer is going to be most likely up here, that's really one of the only primary times you want to even go for that breadth first. But otherwise, the depth first, even if it's way down at the lower levels, you figure you're going all the way down and looking at each one, and you're way more likely to find that answer before you recurse through the whole thing. Versus if you do the breadth first, you're going to have to search all these nodes that you pretty much know it's not most likely at. And then once you get to the very bottom, it's like, oh, those last so many iterations are what's going to find it, instead of like, you know what I mean? Anyway, so self.left, if self.left is not equal to, I'm going to give this a little bit of space down here. If self.left is not equal to none or null, depending on your language, right? Then that means we've got something there. And so if we've got something there, if we've got something there, then we want to do something with it. So then what we'll do is we'll add onto that JSON string, we'd want to add a a left. So we'll say string plus equals, just building on that string, the comma, and then the left word in quotes, double quotes, and then of course another space and a single quote. So we're going to go ahead and tack that on because it's like, okay, we have a left value, so we need to add a little key that says, you know, an attribute, whatever you want to think of it as, it says there's a left. And then we're going to actually add that left value in there. So that left value will be trying to think how I did this before. Okay, so now we're going to start recursing. We're going to call ourselves again, because what we can see here is I'd be tempted to write this, right? I'd be tempted to start doing another val and then put like, you know, value, and then get the left value. So this is where that don't repeat yourself kicks in, that second most important principle. And so since we're not going to repeat ourselves, we'll call ourselves. That's the only repeating we'll do, is repeatedly call ourselves. That's recursion. And then we can see once we come in, it will automatically get that value. So in order to do that, we know there's a self.left, because right here on this line, this is saying, hey, there is a self.left. It's not a none, so process it. So we'll go self.left.serialize. And of course, if you had just written a regular function, you would just call serialize again right here, and then you'd pass it your object.left or your node.left or whatever you called it. Serialize, just like that. And then that's going to do the same exact thing on a miniature scale, a more miniature scale, and it's going to go into that node, and it's going to get the value of that node, and which is a different object, right? It's one of those embedded nested objects, and it's going to do all the same stuff. And then when it's all done, it's going to return that and close it off with a string, because it's going to go all the way down here to return. So right now, if we were to run this, it should give us everything except the rights. It should give us all the left values. So let's go ahead and do that and hit F5. And then, so here we can say, see there's no right values in there. We've got value root, comma, left, all that, just like we pretty much expect. Value left. Okay, this one's value left. It's a little confusing at first, right? So you got your value root, which is that top one. Then while we're still in within that bracket that's starting that object, then that object has a value of root. And then that same object we're in has a left node, right? And that starts a new object right there. And then that object has a value of left instead of root. And then within that same second object, it also has a left node, just like up here. And inside of that left node, that pointer, you know, it has a left pointer, right, to another object, which is another node, and that has a value of left left. And if we count these, we have one opening, two opening, three opening. Then we effectively, that's closing out the third, that's closing out the second, and that's closing out the first. So our brackets, our curly braces seem to be right. So we're on the right track. Now it's going to start getting more downhill and downhill from here. So we can copy this code, and we could come right here and paste it. And we just change these lefts to right here, because we're going to do the same exact thing for the right node, right? And that should do it. So what happens here is it goes and processes on that depth first, sticking to that left side of the tree over there. It's going to do all that, and then it comes back, as it comes back up, it's going to check for those rights, but they're going to be none. This is a really simple example. So they're going to be none, and then it's going to get all the way back up, unwind all the way back up to that root node, and then it's going to come down here and run it, and it'll be like, oh yeah, well, the root node does have a right. So the very last thing it does before it gives us back control of the program, it's going to go ahead and serialize that right node and drill into it, call serialize on itself, which will effectively pass itself into this function when it calls it again. And then we'll say, hey, what's your value? My value is right. And it'll say, do you have a self.left? And it's like, nope, there's no self.left there. So that gets none. It already is none, right? And then it's going to say, do you have a self.right? No. Okay, so we don't need to worry about those. and then it's gonna, we're gonna, that will return a string. It will close itself off and return that little string, and then we'll be back up at that root node effectively, and that root node will close off its string so that all those little curly braces on the right are closed, and we should be good to go. So we'll do that and serialize it, and there we can see value root left. And if we count all these, they should be, you know, if we add for the these opening braces and subtract for the closing braces, we should end up back at zero, right? So we have 0, 1, 2, 3, 2, 1, 2, 1, 0. So we know our braces are good closing. And to check that, we can now, well, we need to write a, the way to check it is to write the deserialize function and then uncomment this, and this should work. So we'll do that. Our serialize function's looking good. We're going to deserialize. And on this one, I'm just going to pass it a string. There's no self. So what I'm saying here, effectively, this would be like a static method in some other languages. So it's going to be a class method. It's not going to be an instance method. And the reason I'm doing that is because I also think this one belongs ideally. This is probably the most ideal way to do it, depending on your situation. I normally try and shy away from like a class method, but it seems to make sense because it's a utility method, which class methods often are, and it doesn't necessarily have an instance to work with, because you want to deserialize, you want to take that string that could come off the internet somewhere or whatever, and you want to turn it into an instance of a type. So it's basically like a type method. And so to me, that makes the most sense to do it like this. And it comes, and it ends up bagged in, this object or this class more, it ends up bagged in with this. So if you import, if this is in a different file, you know, and you import this class, you're going to have all of this functionality within the best context, or the most appropriate context, I feel like. So that's my reasoning behind doing that. So to deserialize it now, we're going to take in a string, and then we want to convert that string into something more, something easier to work with. Like basically what I'm getting at is I'm going to convert it to a dictionary. In JavaScript, you can convert it to an object, right? And in other languages, you'd probably want to use a JSON library to convert it to some type of a simple object or a key value pair sort of data structure format. There's, you know, there's lots of options, but this is the one that's simple and makes a lot of sense. So with that being said, we're going to take in this string, and we're going to do json.loadString, and this will, and then we're going to pass it the string. And so that right there, oh, that's one thing we can do to check this, I guess. So we need to import JSON. It's a core library. Comes with, you know, most all installs of Python, unless somebody's doing a special stripped down embedded version and they leave it out. But the standard distribution, and I imagine a lot of the variations of that, come with JSON out of the bag. So, okay, so we import that functionality and say JSON.loads, which is load string, opposed to dump string if you have a JSON style object. So load string, and then we're going to do node.serialize. And there we go. We get the same thing back because it's serializing it into this string. And then when we pass it to JSON load string, it's converting that to a dictionary. So it's effectively pulling off those outer single quotes. So now, I mean, it's doing a little bit more than that, obviously, but this is a dictionary. So if we did the same thing and assigned it to a dictionary like this, we now have that, right? And so right here, we can actually do kind of like this assert statement where they're like left dot left dot value equals left left. We can come over here and go d dot. We just have to refer to it like this. In JavaScript, you're basically done at that point, because you can refer to it with the object attribute style, the dot notation, instead of this indexing kind of notation. So, you know, arguably I could even say, oh, I'm done here, but I want to do it fully like they said. So there it is. You know what I mean? That's a lot like what they're asking for there with that left vowel compares to left. You could even do compares to left, you get true. But of course, if we did like D dot left, then a dictionary doesn't know out of the box how to handle that. So we're not quite fully deserialized back to a reserializable node, right? Like ideally, I should be able to put even a node, so that's going to return an object there. We should be able to serialize all of this, or I should say all of that. We should be able to serialize all that over again. So we should a actually be able to go like that and then say dot serialize all over again like that and get another string back and then wrap that again with a deserialize like that. You know what I mean? And so on and so forth and just keep infinitely serializing and deserializing. That's, I think, the most ideal way to be able to do that there. Okay, so json.loadString got us to there, which is good. And now what we're going to do is that's going to be a dictionary, so we'll say d for dictionary. That's pretty common in Python is to just use a d. I can't use the word dict because that's a keyword. Dictionary is too long. I want to keep it really general and just reference. Normally, I'm against like one-letter variables for anything more than the very smallest few lines of context, but in this situation with this language, I feel like it's appropriate. But otherwise, I'd probably use like a 3 to 5 character identifier at least, maybe. Okay, and with that dictionary, we want to pop that value into an object. I could call this object node or something, but they've used the word node right here, so I'm just going to go ahead and call this one tree. Same thing, effectively the same exact kind of an object. I just want to show that it's a different variable identifier because this one's out in that more global outer against the rail scope, or of course still inside of a class node here. So that's what scope we're in, and there's nothing called node in here. So we'd be creating a new identifier if we did that. We'd actually be creating the identifier right within here. Okay, so tree equals d dot pop. Of course, in other languages, you're probably gonna have to write at least a few lines, or maybe go and write a little like a object, wrap your little data structure in some kind of an object maybe, and then use pop to get the very last so-called top value out of it. This pop actually doesn't do that. It gets the by key, so you'd want to make a pop thing that gets it by key if you were doing that. So we're going to pop the value out of that dictionary, and that would be that outer value out there. That would be this value. And in a dictionary in Python, when you pop that value, you're removing it. So we're effectively removing, well, the comma too, and you could even say the space. We're going to delete that out of the data structure and return it to ourselves. So the rest of the data structure is just going to have that. So if we say pop.value, and that's going to be in the tree, but in the tree we need to make a node, right? And pass that in. So that's kind of like up here, we're going to make a new node and we're going to pass it a value. And that value is going to be this value. But when we tell it pop.value like that, it's really just going to return that. It's going to delete all of that out of the dictionary, right? But the only value it's going to return is that little string right there. Okay. And then we want to tree.left is going to equal dictionary.pop. And then we're going to pop that left value right here. And that's going to be the same thing because effectively it's going to move that brace over here, that curly brace. And then this left one will be the next one, even though we could pop any of the accessible ones there. But this left will bring everything to there. Or I should say, get that space and that comma effectively too. So it will delete all of that out of the string, out of this outer dictionary, right? and then it will return us that. Or with the last brace too. So it will return us that on that pop right there. But it, what if there isn't a left? You know, like over here we have right with no left, and then once we get down to left, left, there's no left with it. There's no comma left there. So what we need to do is we need to, if there's not a left, we're going to return a none instead. So that's what that syntax is. Of course, that'll be a little bit more crafty in other languages, unless you build up like a little bit of functionality yourself and bring that in. Okay, but I'm going to stick with Python's really good and illustrative and simple, so I'm going to stick with that. So tree.left now either has that little, that lesser fragment of that dictionary, or it has the keyword none in it. So if tree.left, excuse me, is not equal to none, just like above, but the opposite, if it's not equal to none, then we want to continue deserializing ourselves. Just gotta stop and think for a second here. So we have our dictionary. We have our tree. So this is where we're going to probably have to break this up, because I'll show you in just a second. So if tree.left is not equal to none, which I can really just say if, oop, I forgot to put if. So if tree.left is not equal to none, right, then we want to do something with that tree. So then what we want to do is called node.deserialize again. And we want to pass it that little fragment of that dictionary that we popped out. But that fragment of that dictionary is in Python's internal format, like its binary format, right? It's not in the string format we were originally using. So it's like, oh, what do? You know, do we convert it back to a string? We could do that. We could say json.dump string of the tree.left. And we want to be careful not to say dictionary again, because that's sort of like a more global kind of a dictionary. You know, we just want this little tree left fragment of a dictionary that we popped out. So we could do that, and we'll do it for now. But I think this is not optimal because we're converting it back to a string and everything. But do simple first, right? So we'll go ahead and do that for now. And so what that will do is that will call deserialize, and deserialize is basically almost like a standalone function. It just happens to be bound by the class. So that's what this is like. So it's just going to call this function again. It's going to pass it the tree left, reserialize to a string. Then right here, it's going to deserialize it again, just that little portion. And then we're going to assign it to our specific type of objects, right? Not just a dictionary. Pop that value, okay, it's looking like it might work. Not that it will, I'm sure I'm probably forgetting something. I'd be surprised if I wasn't. Okay, and then we'll do the same thing down here, but we want to do it for the right side. Of course, we're doing that left side first, because that's the left side traversal, that depth first traversal, and then followed by the right. Copy and paste that code. You gotta make sure that do all that right. Okay, so then this will do the same thing for the right. Pop the right. If it's not none, then go ahead and recurse and dig into that after it does all the lefts. So on the way out, you know, on the first one, it will come in and do that, and then it will find another left and it will do that, and the whole time it's sort of just leaving effectively a none there. And on its way back out, it will come down and process this. So after, on left left, it will look. It will run this and it will be like, oh, nope, there is no left node coming off of left left. So that will stay at none. Oop, I'm on serialize. I'm a little too high there. Okay, this left, it will stay at none, right, on that left left, because there it doesn't have another. It doesn't keep going, that's it, it's a terminal case. Then it comes back out, and so it skips all that junk, and it comes over here and tests the right. There's also, there's no right little thing coming off of that left left, so that will be a none, and it will just return back out in that case. So do we need to hand it anything back out is the question. And the answer is yes, because our tree.left, yeah, it's a fragment of a dictionary, right? And then we come back in here and we pass that fragment off, but we don't get anything back, so we just have a fragment of a dictionary there. That's not right. We want an object. We want an actual node back. So what we'll say is we'll replace that tree.left, which is something you can kind of do with the dynamics of Python. You can just reuse the same identifier. In other languages that are a little bit too strict, you're welcome to work that out however you'd like. We're going to, this one's right. So we're going to, at first when it calls this, this will be that fragment of a dictionary or the word none, right? If it's the word none, it will just skip past everything and leave it like that. But otherwise it will call it with that fragment of a dictionary. And when it comes back in and runs all this, it's going to return tree. It's going to return that object. So this will, that fragment will get processed and replaced with the reference to the new little node object. And those will all have their respective descending node objects too. So let's see if this works. Okay, no errors, that's good. So if there's no errors and if this works, then we should be able to uncomment this and we should get no errors still. Oh, we got one. Deserialize is not defined. Okay, the reason it's not defined is because just like how I took node out of there and put it right there, we need to do the capitalized N node right here because deserialized, we didn't use it as a free form floating function. We went ahead and added it as a utility class method. All right. Name JSON is not defined. Okay, that makes sense because I never added the import statement up here, so I'll do that. These are all things, of course, in a real coding interview you'd definitely want to watch out for, but they expect people to make mistakes, I'm sure. But you want to practice and keep those to an absolute minimum. All right, so it seems to be working. We didn't get any errors or complaints, so if we take that node object over here and paste it in just to get a visual, like node is there, and if we do node.left.left, there's another object, and if we look at its value, it's left, and we could even use that. Can you use that notation on Python? I don't think you can. On JavaScript, you could. Yeah, you can on Python. That's strictly to dictionary, and then the dot notation is strictly to objects. Of course, there are other ways, but I don't want to get into that. And then we could do node.right is an object, and the node.right value is the string right. So it's looking pretty good. But now, those are the two recursive ways, and as you can see, they're fairly simple. They fit on, you know, maybe half the screen each, which is really ideal there for each method. They're working on that data structure. That's good. But now, what about the iterative ways of doing it? Because that's oftentimes one of the first things that's thrown out as one of those easy ways to spin the whole problem around and see if you can attack it from at least two different ways. So let's go back and implement these iteratively. Def.serial. And we can do a lot of copying here. This is major downhill. So with an iterative, especially with an iterative, most especially with iteratives that are better off as recursive, you kind of want to emulate that recursion, but you're going to do a little bit more of a stripped down method. You need to probably build a stack yourself, which isn't nearly as complex as it might sound, because these problems are so simple iteratively speaking, right? It's like, wow, that's done. Why would I want to build out some stupid looping weird situation? So in that case, if you did, for one, you might have to do it in a code interview, and for two, you might go back and do it as an optimization, because this is not only creating a stack for these values that we see here, but it's also pushing the function itself and like other things that we're not necessarily thinking about so much onto the stack. And that's more weight on that stack. So I guess you could say we're doing a slimmer stack. So the first thing we'll do is create a stack variable, which is like a list or an array list in your language. And then what's common to do in this type of method is to pop out the root value right away. So we need to, not pop out, but push the root value to the stack. So in this case, that would be ourself. So we'd want to do stack.append. Stack.append is basically stack.push in Python, or list.push. Stack.append, and then we'll do self. So we want to start a loop that's a while loop that says while the stack is greater than zero. The length of the stack is greater than zero. Then we want to go ahead and run this loop, because once we're going to push all of our stuff onto the stack, all this stuff, because if you think about what's going on here, we're starting a string, which we're going to need to do down here at some point too. We're starting a string, and then we're checking, you know, if this left value, if it has anything in it, and if it does, then we're going to go ahead and call left.serialize. Well, when left.serialize gets called, this string gets pushed to the stack, with this portion on it as well. So that whole concatenated string gets pushed to the stack. This self.write theoretically gets pushed to the stack. I don't think that's happening physically when that happens, but in our case, we'll need to do that. So, because this whole node is, this whole self right here is getting pushed to the stack as well. So that would implicitly be pushing self.write to the stack. So what we'll do is we'll flip that script. We'll do it the opposite. So we'll come down here, and the first thing we want to do is, first we want to process that node that we just pushed to the stack first thing. So we create a stack like data structure, then we push ourself, our root node, onto that stack, and then we start that loop runs as long as the stack's above zero, and then we want to start popping those values at the top of this. So we're going to pop that root node right back off. It almost seems redundant, and it is the first time around, but it will start to really make sense in a second. So we'll call it node. Doesn't matter, we're within our local scope here, and there's no globally scoped variables called node. And we'll say node equals stack.pop. And so what that's effectively going to do is that's going to pop off self. And since this is Python, I kind of did that in two steps just to illustrate it. We can just do this and go self like that, right? So that might be easier to see that this stack starts off with itself in it. We're going to pop that out and apply it to node. Excuse me. I got to remember we're on serializer now, not on deserialize. A little tricky. So now that we've popped that out, we have ourselves, and we want to basically do a lot of mostly the same thing of what we're seeing up here. But we want to do it in the opposite order. This is where I was talking about the opposite order, because how I was saying, first it's going to go through and do that left side first. So what we want to do is we want to push the right side to our stack, so that the last thing on the stack, is our little stack, is going to be the left side. And then as soon as we get down to left, it's going to come back in here and it's going to pop that left out, and it's going to process it. And then if there was a right on there, that would be on the stack, but it's not. So I'll kind of just let it go here, and you'll see how it goes. It's basically going to push everything on. But okay, let's do the string. So the string, sorry if I'm a little out of order, but this is the way you do it. You know what I mean? You should be able to wrap your head around it as well. And it's easy to kind of chase your tail a little bit. So we need a string, and we want to set that string equal to just like up here. We basically want this same thing here, so like that. But the problem here, for one thing, this self.value, we just changed that to node. That's how similar it is right there. And if you notice, string equals value, every time we go through, it's going to be creating a new string variable. Well, we want to take all that into consideration here, and we don't want to be doing brand new variables. Node's okay, but for the string, we kind of want to build that up. We don't want to reset it every time because we're within this local scope. We're not recursing like we were up here to where it's like, it's okay to reset a brand new string right there because we're doing that every time and it's within its own little local scope of its recursive call. And then when it returns that string and then it appends those results and whatnot. So that's just basically to say we need to create a string up here. That way we can say string plus equals, and we can append onto that string. And we're actually going to add that to the stack as well. So we'll create this string, node pop, that's going to give us node, node value is going to go onto the string, and then we're going to say if node.write first is truthy. So we could have done that with these two, is just get rid of that, just done it like that if we wanted to, right? Be a little bit more succinct. So we're going to do it like that. And if node.write is truthy, meaning it's not none, then we're going to go ahead and push that value onto the stack. Yeah, we're serializing. Okay, so we want to push a string onto the stack, which will be write. And that's got to be in double quotes here. And also one thing I forgot here too, is we're going to need to push a closing brace. Oh, there's no easy, I mean, there probably is an easy way to explain all of this, but I practiced this a couple times and it's just so in depth. There's like, I wasn't able to fully wrap my mind around like the easiest way to explain it in like a more linear logical order. So just bear with me, please. And just go over it yourself until you're able to get as close to that as you can to where you can explain it more linearly. So basically, I was trying to hold off doing some stuff to show you how I kind of build it out, but I'm just going to kind of cut to the chase a little bit and tell you that we need to push the data to the stack as well as the node, but also the string data. Because if you think about that, like I'd mentioned before, each time up here when we go and make this recursive call, we're pushing this string value to the stack as well as that current node itself for when you return. So we have that node itself and we also need to push that string data. So I could either just do like string like that and effectively push this string, which it's effectively empty, right? So I could do either one, whichever one I feel like reads better. It's gonna be a little bit redundant either way, right? So that's that, and those are one-off initializations. Then when we get into here, this is more like what's going on here. That's all more like right within there. This is just a one-off deal. Okay, so that's that. And then when we come in here, that string's first, you can see. So we're going to pop that. And we'll set that to the string plus equals. Because we're within that same scope, we still have this string. And we don't want to overwrite it and empty it with a little fragment each time. So we're going to say string plus equals stack.pop that string. So that's all we're doing. We had a little bit of that redundant. There's going to be a little bit of redundant-ish looking code right here and a little bit right there, whatever. But like I said, that only runs the first time. Every time through after this, this stack's going to pop the strings we push, which we're pushing this one on there. I wrote push. Okay, so that will be stack.append like that, that string. And that string second up there, it might need to go first. I think second works. Sometimes as you're coding it out, you'll realize, oh, wait, I should put, you know, the string first and the node object second or something. It depends on how this stuff plays out right in here. So we're going to do stack.append. We're serializing, so a node write. String. And we want to push this all off for later. So node right, yeah, we want to push off node right. Node dot right, because it is equal. Maybe if you do this yourself, you might want to go through and do iterative right away after you're serialized. But then you don't have deserialized to verify it with, so it's kind of like a catch 22, because once your mind goes back to deserialized, then it messes with your head of trying to figure out like, oh yeah, I'm in serialized mode, not deserialized mode. Okay, so we're going to pass that node right, and that node right, we're dealing with this self object, and it has a node right, and if we're in here, I'll just basically put this back to not equal to none for now so it reads better. Okay, so it comes in here, node right is something, we're going to push that onto the stack first, then we're going to push this little string, and then when it comes back around through, it's going to pop the string into string, then it's going to pop the node into node, and then the string's going to get on, in addition to this right, it's going to get this value that's there because we'll now be inside of that right node. Okay, and then it's going to go down here, and that's all going to be appended on the big string. So you can see right here, we're not actually, we're appending on the stack, not on the string. It only appends on the string right there, at least right now. Okay, and then we'll do the same thing for node left. And we just need to remember to rename all these left. Of course, going in that opposite order. All right, so this is going to pop. So effectively, coming down through, it's going to, on this thing, it's going to push and pop root right away and print its value, you know, add its value to what was an empty string to begin with. Right here's the empty string. More specifically, right there is the empty string. That empty string gets popped into string. The only reason we have this empty string is so that we can use this append operator and get away with it. Otherwise, we could get rid of that, but then we wouldn't be able to start appending. Like, so that would look weird. So that's just the easiest way to handle that. Then after it pops that empty string to string, it's going to pop self to node, which is going to have a root value and a left and a right pointer to those two node objects. And then when it comes down here, it's going to say it will start building up this outer, a little bit more of a globally, I mean, it's not global, but in terms of our little fake recursive thing right here, it's a little bit more global, so to speak, right? So this string, because we have to remember, we're not passing it in and out of a function or a method. We're just adding on to this persistent string, maybe I should call it. And we're going to add on that value, which will be root. That will be that root value. And then we're going to check right. Yes, right exists. So we're going to go ahead and push that right, that reference to that right node that does in fact exist. We're going to push it there. This will be empty again because we've popped out that string in that node, so we'll be back to an empty list, and as if we started with an empty list and then the line under appended or whatever. And so then when we fill it up with this stuff, then self isn't going to be self anymore. It's going to be this node right, you know, it's just going to be a node object just like this was a node object, but it will be the next one down that way. And then this string right here, instead of being an empty string, it will, we'll put in this right string. So that's the way it will be. And then it will leave it like that, and then we'll go down here, and in the first iteration, yes, left is there, it's not none, so it will go ahead and do the same thing and do another kind of like a comma, you know, the node left is going to go there, and then that string is going to go there like that effectively, and it will do that, and then it will finish out the while loop, or you know, we'll get down to the end of the while loop, and then we'll see, come back up here and say, hey, is there anything in the stack? Yeah, there's twice as much as there was the first round. So we'll come in here, we'll pop off that string, which was the left string, then it will pop off that node, which was that left node that we had on the far right of the list, the so-called top of the stack, and it will process those values. And if you can see how that's playing out here, if we have the history, you know, that's building out the string. That first pass through will do root, then it will pop off that left string off the stack, then that will pop off that value, which will just be like value left, like that. It will, so we're about there. And then when we come down here, it will say, is there a right? And it's like, no, there's no right. So it will skip that section. We'll come down here, node left. Is there a node left? Oh yeah, actually there is. There's this little node left right here. So it'll go, okay, well, grab that. So confusing, sorry, I know. All right, node.left, and it will go ahead and grab that node. It's values left, but we don't know. It's just a reference number to some node object. Push it onto the stack. So we still have our original right on the stack, right? We've only popped that second left, and now we're filling that left. So now it's going to look like self, comma, you know, what is the left value node, comma, and then that string, that this string right here, right? So then when we come back out here, we're going to come back down through here, stack less than zero. Nope, we're still double what we started with. Okay, so pop that string, which is this string, left equals, and pop that value, and then put that value in there. So now we're looking like, now we're like that far along, right there. So we're at left value, right? And then it's going to come down here and it's going to say, is there a node right? And it's going to say, nope, there's no little slash, you know, there's not one of these right pointing slashes. So there's no node right. And then it's going to say, is there a node left? And it's going to say, nope, there's no node left either. There's no node left, no node right. Okay, well, in that case, it's just going to loop back around and it's going to say, is that stack equal to zero? And it's going to say, no, we still have that very first right node that we pushed on there. This node right here, we have that sucker on there. And so it's going to go, okay, go in there, pop the string, which will pop this right string. And it's going to say, pop the node, which will pop the reference that that right node originally pointed to. And it's, you know, mostly unwound at that point, so to speak. And then it's going to say, do this string value thing, and it's going to start a new object, right? Well, if we go back over here and double check, you know, that's popping that right string, starting that new object. We can see where it's going. It looks like it's going to work, but we never closed off those last objects. So instead of testing all that out and getting an error like I did before, we'll go ahead and just, whenever we push this guy, or excuse me, push this this value string, we're not actually pushing it, I shouldn't say. We're, you know, building it up. Whenever we build that up, at some point we're going to have to close it with one of these things, right? We can't do it right away because we might have, you know, some amount of opening braces. We don't know, like potentially infinite amount of opening braces before we finally close that sucker off. So all we need to know is that when it comes back all the way up and it gets back up to a certain point, you know, like in this case, when it gets all the way back up to when we're all done with the lefts, we want to start closing stuff off. So what we do is each time, and also when we're all done with the whole thing, right, root's going to have one that closes off once we're all done processing. So each one of these lefts and right even is going to have one that closes off its value, but we want to hold off on it. So what we do is we push that. We build up the string and then we say, hey, we got to push this for later. So we're going to say stack.append and we're going to append that thing on there. But now we've got a problem because with our pattern before, we were pushing an object, and then everything's an object, right? In a lot of these modern program, object-oriented languages, but we were pushing an object object, and now we're pushing a string object. So what we're gonna have here is if we look, we could end up with two string objects in a row. It's like, okay, well, there's, what we could do is we could, you know, one option is to do a stack.append, just like that, and then just push a none there. A none. And then what we could do is we could test right here and say if node compares to none you know, pop that string. Actually, we'd want to do that like right here. We pop that string and then say, if node, you know, add it onto here. So effectively we'll close that off when the time's due. And then if node is none, then continue. So then just go back up and run the while test again. Just skip right out right there. And, you know, if there's anything in the stack, then come back down and process it. That's one option, but it's like, that's kind of crufty. We're pushing a none object. We're getting away with just ignoring nones and everything. So anyway, that's one option. But we don't want to do that ideally. Excuse me. So another option would be to come up here and test our string. And so as soon as we pop that string off the stack, we could say, hey, if string, and then in Python you can say -1 to refer, you know, or in another language maybe like the length of string -1 index or whatever, like the very last character of that string, if that's equal to this, then continue. And that looks like the shortest and sweetest version right there. Like, okay, that I could deal with that. That makes sense, kinda. You know, it's really simple, whatever. That will just continue so that we come back in and we know, okay, pop the regular stack object, whatever. Keep going, you know, like it didn't even try and do that yet, but the next time through we'll be back to our normal pattern and all that. But the problem is that very first time coming through, that's the gotcha on that one, is that this string is empty. And in Python, if you say, hey, give me the last character of an empty string, it's going to say there is no last character in an empty string, which to me is kind of like, you know, like return me an empty string then, you know, like that's honestly, that's the more pure way to do it. But because Python's 30 years old, so whatever, you know, what we could do is though is create a space right there. And then this would work because it would check and it would be like, oh, it's a space, you know, like, or it will have that. But then when we get all the way down to the bottom here, when we return out our, after we're totally done with the while loop and we return string, we would have to do return string dot L strip. So we could do it if we did it like that. But then that's the thing, like it starts out with this physical blank space and it's like, and it ends up kind of crufty again. And then it's like, why did we strip the L strip? And it's like, oh, because of this space. So there's like this cognitive load that comes along with it and everything. So it's like, oh, okay, what, is there another major option that we could do that might be a little bit better than all this? And of course the answer is yes. What we can do is we can come here and pop the stack to a little temporary variable S. And then no matter what, even if it is this character, we want to add that to our string. So we could do the string plus equals S, and then we can test right here. Did S compare to that? And if so, continue. So to me, this is the best choice because we don't have that weird space right there, and we don't have some L strip, L trim kind of thing going on there. And this is kind of like all consolidated right here for what's going on. So we're gonna pop the stack to a super temporary short S variable, like I usually like to use those little one letter variables in the most shortest context possible. And then no matter what, we need to append that because it needs to close off this value, like regardless. And then if that was there, we need to go ahead and continue before we try and pop a node, because the next thing on the stack is gonna be, you know, some string like this probably. It's not gonna be a node. So by going to continue, stack popping again, we're going to pop that string, you know, and then we'll get down here, do the node. That's what's going on with that. Okay. And with all that being said, I'm just going to run it. It might work. I've lost kind of where I'm at specifically, so I'll use the errors to guide me. We need to test this. So serial iterative, come down here, copy this, and just change it around so it, that we make a serial iterative version right here and see if we get the same value. Hey, no complaints. So if we do serial, what's going on? Did I click out of something? Node.serialize iterative. How does node? I must have misspelt it. Serialize iterative. Iterative. Okay, there we go. And then if we also run the node serialize without the iterative on there, they should be identical. And they all look like they line up good and everything's identical. So that's what's going on there. I've drank a lot of coffee today, so I'm going to pause it and use the restroom. But when I get back, which will just be a split second in your time, we're going to do, I might encourage you to take a short break as well, and we will do the deserialize iterative. And then we'll even do one more deserialized, which will take, we'll create an empty object, and instead of using that capital node, it will be like the lowercase node, so that if we just create an empty node, we can say, hey, deserialize and populate this node. So that's to let you go know where we're going with this. Be right back. Pause recording. All right. And one other thing too, if you run into problems, just try and throw print statements in key spots. You know, if it seemed to be working up till whenever, just throw a print statement there or whatever. One thing too is to throw a print statement at the top of that section. So you could put like one right above this string thing here and tell it to print. What would I do for serialize? Maybe serialize is a bad example. Well, right here even. Yeah, I guess serialize is a good example because then you could see how the string's built so along the way. So I could do a print statement right here and then say print string. So the first time through, it's going to be a blank string, right? And then the next time through, it should have, or you know what, instead we could do print string, comma, stack. Let's see what that does. So we can see on the stack the first time through we had that object and that blank string on the stack, and then the string itself. It's doing string then stack, huh? Okay, yeah, the string was blank. That's throwing off the order here. So really this is the pairing like that. There's this implicit blank string right here that you're not seeing. Then this string is next. The next time through the stack, it's got the value root. And that's it, I guess. Is that it? I don't know. It's hard for me to read right now. And then we've got... Oh, no. This is an inner... This is that list on the stack, right? That little brace is throwing me off. Ugh. Maybe don't do both of them at once, if you're like me. So let's just do string and look at that. Okay, much easier. So we can see the first time through the string, or actually the first time through it's blank, right? Then the second time through the string is the value root. It pops that. And then it appends the left, val left, and you can just see how it's appending each one of these little pretty things, and it's working out so nicely. And then the other thing we can do is change that to the stack and print that. And so kind of ugly looking, but anyway, in Python at least, those are the object that represents one node object, right? And then there's that empty string. There's your stack with those square braces. And then right here, you can see after it did that, we went ahead and pushed that curly brace. So you can tell, since we're pushing and popping off the right here, this curly brace isn't going to come back and print till the whole stack's been done. And it unwinds all the way back and handles all this other junk. Then right here, at that very last case, it's going to pop that. Because you can see it builds out and then it winds up and down, so to speak. So this is kind of, you know, for the most part, what's going on in a recursive situation as well. But there's extra, even more details being pushed on, like return addresses and stuff for functions and things like that, and possibly even variables that I would say possibly variables you don't care about, but I can't think of any you wouldn't care about right now. Okay, maybe if the object's more heavyweight and it had more attributes that you did care about, like those might get pushed. Maybe not, just references. Okay, I'll shut up. All right, so where are we at? We're gonna do deserialize iterative. Now that our brain's back in serialize mode, we get to go back to deserialize iterative. And that takes a string too. Right. And a lot of the same process going on here. So one thing we don't have to do this. I'll just go ahead and leave it like that. But one other option, I'll do it different on here. I don't want to make it overly confusing though. Okay. I'll do it the same to start, and then I'll go back and show a couple little optimizations. Okay, so we'll take that string and we will json.load that string into a dictionary, into an internal binary object, much more efficient. I think we all get that by now. And we'll call this tree just to be consistent equals, and we're going to create a node object. What do we have for our node object up here? So it needs to have a value. We can't create an empty one. So we can d dot pop this value here, just like that. And then we will push this. We need a stack. And into that stack, we'll just go ahead and push it like this. We'll say we need to push that tree object, and we need to push the dictionary object as well. I don't know if that's the right order. We'll figure it out in a second. So while the length of that stack is greater than zero, of course, see the pattern? It's the same for deserializing as well, obviously, or not exactly the same, but the really generic template structure is kind of the same. Okay, so we are just converting that string to a dictionary, and then we are creating a node, and we're popping that value out of that dictionary, which will leave that dictionary without that value in it, but it will have the left and the rights and the other values. And then we're creating a stack, and we're pushing that object into it, that node. And then we're also, which is potentially a tree, and that you can name it whatever you want. And then we're also pushing the remainder of that dictionary with that value popped in there. Okay, so when we get in here now, then the first thing to do, since we already have our value, where we already are there, is to tree.left.pop, right? So tree.left dot or equals d.pop. I really should copy and paste. I hate copy and pasting, but I don't want to take too forever with this. So we're going to do the same thing. If it's none, then it's none. And then if there's a couple little switch-ups, of course. If, oh, for one thing, we need to do the right first, right? Just like before. That's like a rule of thumb. Do the right first. Tree.right is not equal to none. And of course, we don't really have to type all that out, at least not in Python, but just doing it to be illustrative. Tree.right is not equal to none. Then we are going to push it onto the stack. So stack.append tree.right. And that's following the format we have now. And then we'll also need to push the dictionary onto there. But we only want to push the fragment of the dictionary. Okay, so that's what we've got right now. If we look right here at what we got going on, that was a dpop, not a stack pop. So that's pulling out that write fragment of the dictionary and storing it in tree write, and then that's not equal to none if we end up in here. So what we're effectively appending right here is that piece of that dictionary. And we kind of got to do that because now after we do that, I want to do a create a node, just like we did up here. We're going to have to kind of be doing this down in here because we could have brought this stuff into the while loop more, or at least this part, like this depop val part. And then we could have not done it as much right here. That's another trade-off. But since it has been done up there, we're going to have to do it before we supposedly emulate that recursion and come back around, because you know, if we depopped val there, we can't come in and depop val right under the top of this while loop, because then it would depop it twice the first time in, right? So by doing that, that means that we did it right before we looped or recursed or whatever way you're thinking of it as. So we need to do that right here right before as well. So we do a stack dot append, and we're going to create a new node there. And that new node is going to get a depop with the val again. All right. And now the problem is that as we go through and we start looping back around, I'll wait 1 second to do it just to keep it simple. Okay, so there's that. We now have the tree, so we need to put the dictionary first, because you see how we pop the we push the dictionary in first. So that's one of those cases where it's like, okay, that dictates your ordering of how you got to do it, because otherwise it's like, well, we'd have to store tree to some other variable name if we really wanted to keep the order, but just in keeping succinct and stuff like that, that's how we'll do that. We'll copy this stuff. Stacked. I must be missing when you go down and it's like that, and it doesn't do the right indention, at least in this editor, that means you probably forgot a closing brace there. Okay, so then that's tree. We just got to fix this all up, so this is all left now. Could do a search and replace, whatever. I just do this, it just takes a second. And technically, if you're in a coding interview, you probably have to write it all out anyway. You don't have that editor luxury a lot of times. All right, so there's all that. Don't see any rights, only see lefts. And that's going to do that, and then it's going to come back out. It's going to depop value into that node. And that's all looking pretty good. And then once we're totally done with that loop, we want to return the tree. Oops. Return the tree like that. So if you see the problem here, we're going to keep on tree.left. It's going to be a node. Stack.append. Where are we not popping? Okay, right here we are popping. Depop right. This is a little bit different than the way I'd done it when I practiced it, so it's throwing me up. When I practiced it, I went ahead and did the depop value within the while loop and just created an empty one out there. But to do that, you have to allow creating a, you have to be able to set this equal to none, just like these. So you have to be able to allow creating a default empty object. But I thought, well, I'll stick with the interface in the strict sense on this try through right here and try and keep it like that. So that's what's going on here. So it's kind of simplified in some regards, but you just have to remember you're creating the node and populating it with that mandatory value, that positional argument right here, and then it comes back through and it's popping the right, which if it's not there, it's going to pop a none, and it's not going to do anything. That's going to come down here, try and pop the left. If that's something, it will push it onto the stack, and otherwise it won't. And what it's also pushing onto the stack is that new node, just like up here, you know what I mean? It's pushing that dictionary fragment and that node. so to speak, or you know, each node's potentially a root of a tree, like a root of a subtree, so you can think of it like that. And then it's returning tree. But what I'm thinking here is that tree should return me the wrong thing, I think. It did before in one of my tests. I'm gonna go ahead and run it and see if it does. This deserialize iterative. Let me go back and stop that from printing. Where's the print? Print should be pink or purple, or there it is. Okay, stop that from printing and then go ahead and hit F5. Okay, now we want to test deserialize iterative. So I'll just page back up. There's serialize, and then we'll wrap that up and say deserialize like that. And this, of course, needs that prefix. Okay, cool. Line 70, stack append val key error. So when we come in here, it's getting a key error. I think what's going on, I'm in the wrong spot. That's the non-iterative, the recursive one. It's only happening if none, and it's coming back up here. It's tree right depop, either that or none. If that's the case, it's going to push those onto the stack. And those values are already populated in there. Maybe by populating the values. So what I did before was I changed this to root so that I'd make sure and return that root instead of the tree. Because maybe, yeah, because tree right is changing every time through there. So this makes sense. Let's see if it works. I'm still not confident with it. Okay, tree is not defined. Oh yeah, tree's not defined, of course. So we just need to do depop. Okay, I'm not popping the whole thing. Tree equals D dot. Okay, the first thing's gonna be the dictionary, right? So we need to do a D equals stack pop, sorry. Stack dot pop. And then we need to do tree equals stack dot pop. There's that little bit of redundancy that needs to line up with this stuff up here. All this stuff you push, you kind of need to immediately pop. So now it's starting to look more like the last time I did it too. Still, I'm doing the value up there. That's a little bit different, but okay. Tree. All right, and we don't need to do push the value to, or excuse me, set the value because that's already set. The dictionary, we're just lining that up with D, so it's not trying to use this whatever outer global thing. This might just work. Then local variable tree reference before assignment. Okay, so that should be root because we changed the name right there. Node object has no attribute pop. Depop right on line 69. It is. Coming through here, we've got JSON load string. Okay, decentralized, deserialized iterative. That's all right. Root gets that value. Pushing the root and this dictionary. And we come in here. We're trying to pop the dictionary first. That's out of order. We need to pop the... Because you can see it's going to pop this first, then that. So this is stuff definitely for a coding interview. You want to make sure you got all that down, right? Otherwise, they'll just probably let you get away with it anyway. If they even notice. So, tree stack dot pop, d stack dot pop. At least on the early initial coding interviews. The harder core whiteboard interviews are probably wouldn't get away with that. So, let's check it now. Line 72, stack append, key or value. Why, oh why do we have that key or value there? So we're popping the tree to stack.pop, which will be the root at first. Then we're popping the dictionary to D, which is going to be the dictionary that we pass in, which is node serialize as a string, but it's going to convert it to a dictionary. And even if we look at that, that's what's going in there. Okay, and then while the stack's greater than zero, length of stack, pop that, then tree.write equals d.popWrite or none. So if tree.write is not none, then come in here and stack.append tree.write, which is the dictionary. And then after that, stack.append this new node, which is root. We didn't set the tree.write to point to this new node. That's what the problem is. So right here, we need to create this and call this tree.write. That's one thing like you see me doing where I'm going over every line of code, even though I'm tired and stuff. That will refresh you on what's wrong. Just literally stop. When I did my over the phone Google Docs tech interview thing, coding interview, they had me, that's a common thing for them to do, is have you go over like, okay, stop, and just can you explain what each line of code is doing to me? You know, they might do it for their own reference just to see if you can do it, various reasons. And if you study a lot of these problems, that's one thing that you should always just stop and do. Just stop. And I used to tell people that all the time when I would tutor them and stuff, like, just stop and go over every line of code and see where you're at. And that way you're just wrapping your head more and more and more around that problem. And by the time you finish it, even if it takes you half the day or all day or whatever, you know that code inside and out. You know, you can just glance at it and like explain to yourself what's going on. And the idea is to keep doing that until it's second nature for us, right? So we're going to assign tree.write. At first we come in, tree.write is going to be that dictionary fragment. If it's not equal to none, then we're going to, which it will return if there is no dictionary fragment. And then it will say stack append that dictionary fragment, which will go in that first spot. And then tree.write, we're going to go ahead and set to a new node because we're deserializing. So we're having to create nodes now instead of reading them, right? And I mean, we're kind of effectively reading them out of this little flattened serialized hierarchy tree thing, but the JSON. But we need to create physical object nodes, so to speak. So we're going to create that node and actually point something. We got to give it a reference to remember. We can't just create it off into the oblivion like I was. And then now tree write is equal to the reference pointing to that node, and we can just pass that new version of tree write like that. And then we could do the same thing with tree left down here and just all right. Deserialize. What am I doing wrong now? Tree.72 deserialize. Line 72 deserialize iterative. Tree.write equals node. Pop.value key error value. Okay, so what I'm trying to do is a depop. That's where I'm wrong. That depop is referring to whatever. We've already popped that value the first time we come in, so there is no value when we enter in up here. That was sort of a, I guess, a leftover little habit from my last practice on this, is that so what we need to do is we re need to refer to this tree right fragment of a dictionary right here. So I can say tree dot right dot pop. And you're welcome to reuse or rename different variables or instantiate new little variables or whatever, assign whatever makes it most readable and simple. I'm not necessarily doing it the most perfect way or whatever. I'm just trying to lean towards keep it simple and don't repeat yourself. Stuff like that in the way that kind of seems to me to do so. All right, so yeah, just make sure you're not naming anything or you will get yelled at by the errors. And then one other thing too that's easy to do is make sure this return statement is actually outside of this while loop and you're not returning within the while loop. There's lots of little problems I've run into practicing these kind of problems where it's just like, oh, you know, like the longer it takes, I know like the stupider the mistake I'm making. I just know it's like one time I had done the deserialize, I was setting this up in a little, this was just like a little wrapper initialization function. I did these couple lines and then I called off to another dictionary to object function that I created or method. And, that allowed me to like just it was a little bit different approach I was taking. Well, the thing was I was returning my thing down here, my object, my nodes, but they weren't going back to my program, and I can't believe I must have spent like an hour or something, just some crazy amount of time. And then I finally realized because I had broken this up into two methods, you know, I was returning from this method, but ultimately my program was getting back from this little mini method, and I was like, oh wow, I knew it was something stupid. So anyway, that's that. And did I fix this? Yes. Did you see that? Blue happy. We got an object back. So now if we run the same thing and assign that to like an n equals, and then we do n dot left, n dot left dot value, is it left, right? And then we do n dot left dot value. Cool. So it seems to be working. And then we could, of course, infinitely do that and then wrap this one in a. Well, what we do is we'd assign that to n, right? Just like that. And then we say that n dot serialize. And then it gets serialized again, and then we could do that and wrap that in that node dot deserialize. And just like infinitely just keep serializing and deserializing it, you know what I mean? And set this one to like m equals that. So now we're so many times through the rabbit hole loop, so to speak, or whatever, and we could change this to n dot serialize dot iterative at will, you know, and it's still gonna work. Like we can pick whatever ones. Oh, were we using, yeah, deserialize iterative. Use both of them like that, right? There we go. M dot right m dot. And all these things that you want that you're tempted to do, all those tests, you can just turn into assert statements, and you can even keep them in different files and whatnot. This could become serialize iterative. Oh wait, I already had serialize it. Okay, well we'll just do deserialize iterative. Like that, you know, and then you don't have to type it all out. It's just gonna yell at you with all that red error dump. Like if I change one letter in this, like get rid of that T. See, so now it's like, hey, it doesn't compare to left dot left. That's an assertion error. So if you see assertion error, you know it's one of your little tests that didn't pass, and it's like, oh, well, in this case, it's not our code up here. It's just because I gave it invalid value. Then you fix whatever's wrong with your code, rerun it, and no errors, which is kind of the Unix utility tool convention of, first of all, do one thing and do one thing well, and second of all, try not to complain, do everything silently unless there's a problem, and if there's a problem, yell loudly. And that's what's going on there. Okay, so for the finalest thing here, for one thing, there was another. I have this book, Programming Interviews Exposed. I think I have the third edition. There's a fourth edition at least out now. I know that has a little bit more stuff, but anyway, some people say, oh, this book's not that great, it's not rugged enough or whatever, but I like it because it's like if you're a beginner or intermediate or really rusty or something, it really is just like it's not going to show you like the best way to do every single problem. It's not like the Gale book, and even then I found like, none of those books are perfect. But this one's a really nice, builds a little bridge for you to if you're just beginner, intermediate or whatever, you're working towards expert, this will get you on that path to where it's a nice, it's just such a good book for like 200 pages, and half the price of a lot of the other ones. But what I'm getting at is there's this other little tree in here that I was using as some test input because it's actually kind of a little bit bigger of a tree and flip the other direction. So it's, we'll just call it N. N equals, and it has a node with an A. Bear with me for a second while I punch this stuff in. A B, then B's it for that node, and then the right below A, there's also a C. That C has a, and I'm basically doing the left first traversal, depth first traversal to the left. As I'm doing this, I'm just going, okay, there's one node off to the side of, under A. I should go ahead and just do this. Maybe it'll be easier to follow along with. And then under A, there's a B only, and then a C. And then under C, there's a node D on the left. And under D on the left, there's a node F, and under F there's nothing, so that's a close. And but also under D on the right, node is G. Am I forgetting commas here? Okay, node G, and then under G there's nothing, so I can close that one off. I'll just put that down there like that. And that covers D. And then under E, okay, under C, there's also an E. You can see we're lined up with C here, and then there's no D under it, and then on the, that's the left node first, and then the right node, E. And under E, there's only a right node H, but I need to say none here specifically, because otherwise, if I just pass the H, then it will think I'm talking about the left node and it will assign the right node a none. So then I'll say node H like that. I think I've got it all, and then close that one off, which closes off that node, then a comma. Then we'll close that node off, then a comma. Those ones, that's it. All right. So now we can take these same asserts, almost the same asserts, right? This is a different tree, so the values left isn't going to work on this tree. And maybe you might want to pause it if you're really into it, pause it and draw this one out. Try and draw it out ASCII wise, and try and draw it out and paint. You know, it's roughly twice the size of the other tree. It's not that bad. There's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. So yeah, literally twice the size of the other tree and flip the other way around mostly. Okay, so if I follow down on this tree, I'm going to go A right, left, right should be G. A right dot left dot right value should be a G. And then A right, right, right should be H. Well, I'll go ahead and do these two the same since they're iterative versus non-iterative. Right. Actually, this one's not so much. Okay, we'll just do right dot right dot right value dot 8 is a H. I'll just try all random different ones. Okay, A dot left is B. And the idea, of course, like I was mentioning earlier, is just you should have a ton of these assertions in another file that imports your file. Your file shouldn't know about the unit test. And that's what unit testing is this kind of a thing. And then you'd import this class, and then you'd instantiate instance of it and just do every little variation you could think of that you'd want to type at the console, right? To make sure that, like, you know, even this none, I didn't have a test for that specifically. And I was thinking that I had my node H on, you know, I had just originally done E and then node H and left it like that, you know. So let's check that that one's there. That's A dot right, right, left should be. So right dot right dot left should be a value of none. All right, so that's going to do n. So what we need to come up here and do is n is that node. So we're going to say n dot serialize and dot serialize. Okay. Attribute error on line 112. None type object has no attribute. Line 112. Let me make sure I got that right. Right, right, left. Oh, it's not value, because that's the thing where it's like on here. It's not technically, like, for it to be a value, it has to point all the way into a new object to get that value thing, right? But with these nones, it just is like a stub. It doesn't actually point all the way to an object, so there is no value right here, right? There should be a value right there, so that's why it's not finding it. So what it is just this attribute right should just directly equal none. That's what's going on there. So I can just go like this, and that should work. And it seems to. Okay, you know what? Real quick, I think I didn't do one last thing that I was planning on doing, believe it or not. So what I was going to do is create a subclass. Like, what if we could create, instead of like assigning node to n and then building out this whole thing, what if we just create a variable called like binary tree, just to name it something different, and we say it equals a blank node object like that. And this blank node object, like, then we could build it on itself. Like, we'll go like this, Control C. And what we'll do is we'll replace that with binary tree, Control C. Binary tree equal binary tree dot deserialize. Okay, so now what's going on here is this will, if you notice, the node's not, the deserialize isn't capitalized node anymore to prefix it with. So we're going to make it an instant variable, just like serialize. But what we're going to do is we'll have an empty object and we'll say, hey, if we pass you something to deserialize, make yourself become that tree structure. So of course you'll want an empty object, and that's where we run into a problem right here, because this value doesn't allow you to create an empty object. We could set value to none, you know, we could come down here and say node value none and probably get away with it like that, which, you know what, maybe that does read better. So I hadn't done it like that before, but what we do just to get it rocking here is we do another class and call it deserializable node, and it's going to inherit from node. So it will inherit like serialize and all the other functionality effectively. And then here's the thing to wonder about is this initialization function. Like, do we want to duplicate that? You know, it wouldn't be the hugest deal in the world if we did. It's not a complete violation of dry because it's really with... Let me dedent that a little bit. Oh. Whoa, these are... It's weird. I lost some of this formatting here. Okay. So it's not a complete violation of dry because it... You know, it's only a one-off thing, and it's like sometimes you got to do it, but ideally you don't want to do it. It's like, really, are we going to reduplicate this whole thing just to be able to put none there? So one option is to just make this one optionally take none right here, like that, and then we could just skip it. We could just totally skip this whole constructor initializer thing right here. But then that does change this interface. Really, if people aren't expecting the, if somebody's relying on the fact that they're going to get an error if they don't pass a value here, then that would be bad, right? If we had made a public API and everything and made this publicly available, we wouldn't want to change that interface if there's any chance that people would be relying on that value. But otherwise, it, you know, short of that, it's like we could just implement it like that, and then we could skip out having all of this, that extra junk, you know, then it, repeating all of this just to do this for this one specific thing. But of course, like I said, one of the trade-offs we could do is just do that, and then that leaves this interface solid and intact, and if people were relying on getting that error, if they didn't provide that value, then that's good to go. And then you could do a little bit of duplication here, you know, and just set this one optional like that. Or obviously the other way is you could allow somebody to deliberately pass none. And with this last way, they could still deliberately pass none. It would just be optional. So maybe we'll do that. Maybe we'll say it's optional to pass none, just like that. But the other option would be to, of course, to enforce it with the value like that, in which case, if we make it like that, then we're forcing them to write the readable code. It's only one value there. It kind of shows that it's empty, and then we can get rid of that class, that constructor method. We can just use this one up here because it will still require them to put none. So I'm going to go ahead and go with that. I think that's the simplest option now. And then if we want to make it optional in the future, we could do that, and that won't break backward compatibility. That's one of those situations where either way you could probably do it, but I think this one's technically, this one's a little bit simpler, and it's a lot drier, or, you know, a good swipe drier than the other way, so this would be the way to do it initially. And it doesn't break backward compatibility, whatever. Those are, I say those things and it sounds so petty with what I'm doing right now, but that scales, you know what I mean? When you're doing bigger, badder stuff, that idea right there will scale. So we'll create this empty object, and then we just want to provide an override for, well, it's not even really an override, because what we're going to do is we're going to do it's polymorphism in the more real sense. We're going to do decentralized, but we're going to pass it a self, and this self, so deserialize, did I say decentralize? I meant deserialize if I said that. Deserialize, we're going to pass it the self, and then we're also going to pass it that string, right? And it's going to be a lot the same as the deserialize up here. So, as a matter of fact, just to try and make it go as quick as possible, I'll just copy this and try and edit it, most of it in place down here. Okay, and what the deal is wherever it says tree, we're just going to make that say self instead for the most part. And it can even call the function on itself and everything. And so what we need to do too down here before I forget is actually make this say deserializable node. Okay, just like that. That way we create a specific instance of this subclass, which is a more specialized class because it's either extending or offering more specialized behavior. So that's when you want a subclass. You don't want to like predetermine subclasses. Let them happen like naturally like this, ideally. Okay, so deserialize, it's going to take an instance of itself and a string, and then it's going to convert that string into a dictionary object. It's going to do that tree is going to become self. So it's self, but instead of creating a node, we already have a node in theory, right? Because we create that empty node. So all we need to do is set our value. So we're going to pop that value and say self.value, and then we will set our self.left to pop that left value out. And then if self.left is not equal to none, and we can even do this to make it a little less wordy in our situation, if self.left is good, then spell this right. If self.left is not none, I almost like it with none there better. It just reads better. But anyway, better to be explicit than implicit, I think, in some situations. So I'll stick with that, whatever. You know, if I'm feeling more comfortable with it, then leave it like that. It's no big deal. All right. Node. Then what we want to do is we want to call ourself again. Self.deserialize, not that class one. And instead of this JSON dumps thing again, I'll show you just to show you how it could be done instead. If we just want to be able to pass tree left without dumping it back to a string, what we can do here is go like this and say, define a new method, call it dict2Object. And it's going to take a dictionary, right? And then what we'll do here is, we know this is a dictionary, so we'll call it, we need to make sure and return, right? Return this value. That was one of the things I mentioned earlier that I had a problem with when I broke it up like this. Return from dict to object, or dict to node, whatever you want to call it. And it's going to pass it, this effectively will result in a dictionary, and it will come right down here and do this. So whatever we return from this will come right back out here and immediately get returned back to the caller. All right. Self, d.pop should be fine. Self. And then this is going to become self, which is just saying call this instance. You know, this is now, ooh, speaking of that, this needs to get a self to make sure it stays instance too. But notice how all I did was pass it this one parameter right here, because this first parameter automatically, if it's self, it gets passed in, you know, like that. All right. If you call it on itself, I should say. Because it's like, wait, how does it know whether or not to be a class method or not? And what it is if you attach it to an object. You know, if you call it on like a lowercase, like if you call it on that object, it's going to pass this object as self, right? But if you call it on the class, it's not going to pass a self. It's just going to call it within this class definition, right? So that's the difference there. Okay, so all that stuff, self-deserialization, and then we don't have to keep converting this because it's already, you know what I mean? We're skipping that. We're doing that once off. So this is an optimization. Ideally, you would want to do it the way I did before, probably with the JSON dumps, because that's a little simpler. This is starting to break stuff up and getting a little bit more complex, but the optimization justifies it on the second or third or nth pass through, because it's like, okay, that's a lot of extra conversions. If this is like some service running on a server that's just really running hot, doing this a lot, and it's like, hey, you could basically, chop off a serious amount of resource usage right there just by doing that. So that's the trade-off. Okay, and then we're going to return self, I think, if I have all this right. Oh, these are okay, self.write. So if we run back through it, it's going to call deserialize with an instance and a string, and then it's going to call dict object with the string converted to a dictionary and return whatever value it gets back from that to the original caller. And here's dict object. It's going to take an instance as well and that dictionary, and then it's going to pop the value into itself, and then it's going to pop left or none depending into itself dot left. If self dot left is not none, then it's going to, this needs to be self dot left in both of these. It's obviously good to read it back to yourself like this if you're practicing without an editor. You aren't going to have the thing to run it, so until hindsight, so you'll want to read it and kind of think about where you're at, and even run through a few iterations yourself of like, okay, like we did with that non-recursive version, the iterative version of like serialize and deserialize, to get an idea of where it's at, and then jump maybe towards the end case of what you would expect, all that kind of stuff. Okay, so it's going to take self.left, which is a dictionary fragment at this point, and it's going to call self.deserialize up here. So we don't want to call deserialize. I screwed up right there. So I want to change this to dict to object. Dict. It's like that, okay, because if I call it there, it's expecting a string, right? So the whole point was to make the recursive call just take the dictionary. So that will work right there. It will take the dictionary, and what's tree.left? That's supposed to be self.left. So it's setting self.left to the return value of this, so it will effectively erase that dictionary fragment and replace it with this return version of, once it gets all the way down here, which will have the right value and all that stuff. So in theory, this might just work. So this is deserializable node deserialize. Let's come down here, double check we have that right. So deserializable node binary tree, and it's going to call deserialize on itself, not on the class type. And it's going to take that stuff. All right. Let's try it out. Dict to object is not defined on line 87. Oh, okay. So we just have to call self dot. There we go. Instance method, right? Duh. You probably already caught that. None type object has no attribute right on line 132. Line one. Down here's the line numbers in this editor. So has right left right val g. That one sure had it, so that's showing us that something went wrong there. Right on the first one too, so that's a good sign that just something totally wonky happened there. So we're coming in. I'm thinking maybe this returns self. It's gonna keep returning self. That's gonna assign to self left, self right, and this self value. That all looks right. Deplop that. One thing we can do here is print the dictionary. See if that gives us a clue. And it's getting all the way down there. Value H starts out like that, and the dictionary is breaking off into fragments, right? And it looks like the first fragment is value B. which makes sense, that's for left. And then value C, which is for right. Kind of wondering why it's already going to right there. Self left. Are we not creating a new instance to call? Is that the problem? I don't see anything that's creating a new instance. So we're just literally calling ourself. That's not right. We need to create a new node. Node with none as the initial type there, and then call that function. So it's kind of like pseudo recursion again, I guess. I mean, it's very recursive, but oops, that's supposed to be none. So it's arguable whether or not that's like, I mean, I think I consider it recursion. It follows all the same rules of recursion. You just got to make sure you get this prefix right, you know. But otherwise, it's calling a new instance of itself. It's just object-oriented recursion, I guess, specifically. So this should do it. Because we're creating this, we're assigning this self.left. Now we're getting at a new instance. So it's going to point to that new instance. Well, effectively, it's not. First, it's going to evaluate all this stuff before we can even talk about what happens on that left-hand side, right? So it's going to create a new instance with none. It's going to call dict.object on itself, pass this in. Then it's going to replace that none value with the real value that's in that dictionary fragment. Then it's going to set its left and right accordingly and recurse and do all that stuff. Then when it gets all done, it's going to each one of those recursions is going to return itself, which is a reference to itself, right? Which is same as that by itself would return, you know. But when we call this object, when we call this method on there, it's like, well, do we know for sure we're going to get, you know, it might just return none or something. But it down here, we can see we explicitly set it to return itself. So this self.left, I think it will work. Oh, of course not, right. Node object has no attribute dict to object on 94. Oh, because I'm doing no instead of you might have caught that. Deserialized node. Definitely save some typing on that one. Okay. So we need to specifically make a deserialized node. But if you notice, the binary tree, all we have to do as far as like on the user end, not on the internal, you know, on this end, yeah, we do have to specifically call deserialized node to like get the same effect if we want. Or we could in turn, since we're subclassing this other stuff, I think we might even be able to call one of those other deserialized methods. But specifically right now, the way we're rolling with it to stay consistent, we're calling deserialized node. And so that's what we need to do internally. But out here, if you notice, you only have to call deserialized node like once. But you can pass it a node created like up here, these nodes created with just plain old nodes. Like, that's fine. And that's one of the benefits of, what is that principle called? The principle where you want to make something accept a subtype. Like, you can pass a subtype as though it was a more general type. I can't believe that term's escaping me right now of what that's called. The substitution, Liskov, Barbara Liskov, that's her name. I was trying to remember her name. Barbara Liskov is like one of the most important people in computer science, computer engineering, in my opinion. I was getting her name confused with like Rebecca Werf Sprock, who is also badass. She's more like a decade or so later as far as like in her prime of just like putting out the info. Barbara Liskov was like 70s, I want to say, like maybe late 70s. Rebecca Werf Sprock, early 90s was her prime. Both of those women, speaking of women in tech, like both of those women just, they drop it. But yeah, that's the substitution principle saying you should do that. So whenever you're on the fence about how do you design like an object or a subtype and all that kind of stuff, a subclass, all that, then that's the really simple idea you want to fall back to. It sounds crazy, Liskov substitution principle, but it's the simplest thing. It just says that you guarantee to provide that interface of the more general type that you're inheriting from. You at least that interface. If anything, you're just going to extend or override it. But that way, anybody who's expecting that won't be too surprised if they get your two string method, so to speak, might be different. But they can still call that in an instance where they want a string. You could give them an entirely different string, maybe, but at least they know they have a reasonable expectation of what they're going to get back there. Okay, now I just blabbered so much, I totally forgot. I'm going to hit F5 again and see where I'm at. A deserialized node. Deserialized. It's deserializable. I don't like big long names like that for those exact reasons, but I couldn't think of a simply more appropriate one. Boom, close. Deserialized iterative takes one positional argument, two given on line 135. I know. Line 135. What did it say? Deserialized iterative takes one positional argument. Okay, so we tried to call this should be node.deserialized iterative, right? Because we didn't give it that we didn't do an iterative version of that last one, which I'll leave as an exercise for yourself if you want to do that, because bam, there it is. And now we can get rid of that print statement or print D right here, or comment it out, whatever you want to do, but those are obviously very helpful. Bounce back over here, F5, all those tests, no errors. And then we can see when we initialize, so we'll just make something called like NN equals, so like new node or something, and we'll set that one up as a deserialized none, just like this. Oops, what was that about? And then if we do NN, we can see we have something, but if we do NN.val, it's none. NN.right, nothing. And of course, .left, nothing. But then if we go ahead on NN and call this, specifically call this kind of a thing, let's just say that far right there. NN dot that. So now we're going to pass it that n, which somewhere up in here silently when we ran it was created this big old node right here, right? That thing. And we're going to deserialize that one, or excuse me, we're going to serialize that one into JSON from the internal object format. And then we're going to use NN, which is an empty object. We just tested it right here. It's empty, right? So then this should populate that empty object with the deserialized version. There we go. NN is now all still an object. And then, but if we go up to its left value, oh, it's got an object there now. And we go up to its right value, oh, wow. And then we do its NN.val. So you see, all right. And then we could, of course, do that NN.left.left.val. And we, ooh. Is that right? Okay, whew. I was freaking out for a minute. I was like, I want to do that cool first one we did. The thing is, I'm using this object instead of their test object, but just to bring it all home, we'll do this one. So the same thing with node. Alt P, P, P. And wait, down one. So instead of n right here, we'll do node. Okay. Now what I meant to do was nn.left.left.val. And that equals left.left. So there it is, and I would encourage you to write more tests. I'm glad you paid attention this far if you're down enough to do that. We used more inputs because this one was a good, simple, really good simple input to start with, honestly, but not a good one for more thorough testing and even create more random trees and stuff like that. And maybe something that prints out a tree, what it looks like effectively, like all sorts of plays off that. We have deserialized, we have serialized, serialized iterative, deserialized. Those two are, these two, they have the self, they are instance methods. These deserialized are just utility, static, class methods, whatever you want to think of them as. There's the iterative version. Of course, I'm not going to. And then down here, we have this one that overrides some of the functionality of the one up there, and it just overrides that plain old recursive deserialized one, and it goes ahead and populates itself. And there's all sorts of tricks you can do. You can say, hey, if they do pass this or don't pass that, and da 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 da. Just that's where we're at. If you really want to take this one little tiny step further, then go ahead and try and make this one iterative. And hint, it should be pretty easy. You just come up here and look at the deserialize iterative and combine that. And just basically, well, I've never tried it, so I don't want to over-explain it right now of what it would be entailed. But that one right above it, that deserialized iterative, that's what you'd want to look to. And of course, this tree stuff, you're going to replace a lot of that. That's interesting. I might have to try that for myself. But yeah, that's what you might want to reference, and maybe at the same time you might want to not reference it. It might throw you off and just think from scratch, since you probably get the idea now about the stacks and everything. So thanks a lot for watching. Have a good one.